Good morning, everyone. I welcome you again to Basic Technology class for this week. Inshallah, this morning we shall be looking into the topic Woodwork Hand Tools. As the name implies, woodwork, that is any woodwork project that we have that leads to wooden products of various sorts that we have that we can see all around in our surroundings. Now, these products have been made from one particular item and the other, and they have all involved processing. But before I proceed, let us understand certain concepts in technology. When I'm talking technology, before any product can be made, there are certain concepts that be involved. First, we have material to use to make that item. Then we have tools and or machines. Then we are going to have processing, and all this leads to product. So in a simple mathematical technology, I'll say that technology involves these concepts. So material plus tools or machines plus processing equals product. Now, just like we have discussed in previous topics, we discussed so many types of materials that are used in technology, starting from wood, metal, clay, ceramic, glass, plastic, rubber, etc. So these are materials, existing thing that we use to make products for human. But not just this, we need to change these materials from their natural form into various usable forms. So the changing of this material from one form to another usable form is what is called processing. Meanwhile, this process is achieved only with the use of tools and machines, because it's not possible for us to use our bare hands to convert any material, to change them into a usable form with our bare hands. It's practically not possible. So processing starts from the stage where we transport logs of timber to sawmill. So when trees are felled, they are cut into big logs which are transported to the sawmill. And that's where processing starts from. So, processing starts from the cutting of these logs of wood into plant of timber and other marketable sizes. So, processing starts from there. Then from there, I want to use so many different tools and machines to work upon timber from one stage to another to convert them to usable form until the final finished product which we use for various purposes. Mind you, here we are talking strictly, basically on woodwork, after which I talk on a metal work. So I'm seeing essentially that any wooden product has involved use of material, then processing, which is done by the use of tools and machines to give a final product which we use in our various forms and other places. Now, tools and machines. So under this, let me say that these machines, the part of machines, I think we are going to deal with that in our subsequent topics, maybe by the time we get to GS3 or so. So for now, when we say woodwork hand tools, refer to those smaller handable tools which we use to work upon wood or timber to make products out of them. So these are the major concepts involved in the technology. So now we are going to be discussing the tools. So those tools that are involved in a woodwork project. Now, these woodwork hand tools are classified into six major groups. They are classified into six major groups. First, let me make a list of those groups over who don't hand tools. One, we have measuring tools. We have measuring tools. We have setting out. And marking out tools. We have driving tools. We have boring tools. We have work holding devices. And then you have cutting and pairing tools. So these are six major groups of woodwork hand tools, each of which has a particular set of operations for working on the wood. So not just this, basically any woodworker, we have what is called a bench in their workshop. The bench is actually a general purpose holding device. So it helps us to make so many operations involved in woodwork possible. So if you want to cut, if you want to saw, if you want to plane, if you want to carry out anything, so a woodworker, a carpenter, or name them, we have basically what is called a bench in their workshop. So basically, any woodworker, you have what is called a bench in the workshop. Is made of is like a table. It's like a table that is stationed in the workshop for working. It is used for holding the work, for placing work, and so many other operations you want to carry out on work to make it possible. Because it is practically not possible to have our work. When I say work, I mean the item you are working upon. Whether you are cutting, you are playing, you are sewing, you are painting, whatever. So what is being worked upon is what is called work. So it's practically not possible to have it in our hand while we use the other hand for working. So we need a bench. So the bench is a basic device that is found in any woodwork shop. So this is a picture of a bench. We have seen it in the many workshops. So it has beside it some metal device that is for adjusting work. If you want to carry out painting or other finishing, we don't hold work in our hand. We need to place them on the wall. So that is a general purpose device. That's why it's not stated categorically. So now let's start with measuring tools. Measuring tools are those tools that serve the purpose of measuring linear and angular, such as length, breadth, width, etc. Because let me remind us again that technology involves so many things. It starts from the use of scientific ideas. It involves drawings, it involves measurements, it involves so many things. So for you to make any woodwork or even metal work or whatever, you have to carry out measurements to be specific. That is to determine the dimensions of what you want to make. So in that case, you need measuring tools. So measuring tools generally serve to measure the dimensions, angular, those linear angular dimensions of a woodwork project. So, measuring tools, let me clean this out and make a list of the measuring tools that we have. I'm sorry, I've made a list of six groups of woodwork and tools, but with time you have, won't be able to discuss everything this morning. I think with time you have, we won't be able to exceed the measuring tools and setting out and marking out tools for thorough discussion and understanding. Now, measuring tools. So, measuring tools involve, they include the following. We have a tape measure. We have tape measure. So the tape measure is an aluminum measuring device that is a retractable. Yes, many of us have seen this device in the hands of a carpenter. As you can see, this here is a retractable aluminum tape. So it is calibrated in centimeters, millimeters, etc. Then it is retractable. It is housed in a plastic casing this way. So when you want to use it, you simply draw it out of the casing and take measurements of what you want to make. Once it is released, it is retractable in the sense that it will draw out, it will draw itself back into the plastic casing. So this is used for taking measurements of length, linear measurements. So it is capable of measuring up to 750 centimeter length. So that is a tape measure, otherwise called rectangular tape, measuring tape or rectangular tape measure. The other one we have is a foldable wooden rule. Foldable wooden rule. This is another measuring tool. As you can see, it is made of a straight wood in the form of ruler, of the thickness of a ruler or a little more than that. It's also calibrated. As you can see, it is folded in length. It is foldable in length. This here is made, it is done in such a way that it is portable. That is, you can fold it and keep it in a bag, or we have this wherever we need it. So it is made in a foldable form. The total length of this is about 180 centimeters. It's not as long as the tape measure. So it's still used for measuring length. If you want to measure length, breadth, or width of a woodwork, so you can also use it, but it can only measure up to 180 centimeter. So another one we have is a pair of dividers. Now we are familiar with this name in the previous topic when we discussed the drawing instruments and materials. Pair of dividers, it is a two-legged metal instrument, though the head is made of plastic usually, but the stem is made of steel. So the two legs are pinpointed. They are pinpointed. So this there can be used to pick measurements in proportion to one another. For instance, we need like a circle, a particular radius, and we need them in proportions elsewhere on woodwork. So after having measured, taking the first measurement, I just use this instead of repeating measurement, I just use this to pick the length, the distance between 2 points that we need to produce them, somewhere. So this is a pair of dividers. So like I said, it is used for picking a measurement. Sorry, it is used for picking measurements in length in proportion to one another. Now another one we have is a caliper. Calipers are available in different forms. They are available in different forms. The first one. They are available in different forms. So you have the calipers also have two legs. They are two-legged metal instruments. They are used for taking diameters. This okay, let's have a look at this. So this is a more advanced one, it's more expensive. I can see this the simpler ones there. Simpler forms of okay. So this is a more advanced form of a caliper. So this you said that it has two pairs of legs. This for measuring external diameter, and this for measuring internal diameter. Other forms exist, something like this. So all these forms of the calipers are seen on the board. Okay. So yes, as you can see, if you take a look at this, this here, it has its two legs curving outwards. Yes. So calipers are just similar to pair of dividers. Yes, this is pair of dividers. This is a caliper. As you can see, the legs curve inwards. The legs curve inwards. This type of caliper is used for taking external diameter. If you want to measure thickness, the thickness of the wood block, for instance, now. If you want to measure the thickness of the wood block. Say for instance this, if this here is a wall, I mean a piece of wood that we are working upon, we want to make something out of it. So we are carrying out processing, so it involves measuring. So the caliper that has its legs curving inwards is used for taking the external diameter, that is thickness. So it measures the diameter this way. So that's why it has the leg curving inwards, so that you'll be able to hold it this way and take the measurement. So that is used for taking the external diameter. Now, the one that has its leg curving inwards, it is used for measuring a hollow walls. That is the wood walls that have holes in them to measure the internal diameter. So to measure the internal diameter, we know that it's not practically possible to take measurements of that today, any other thing than to use the one that has its legs curving outwards. So mind you, don't be confused. The caliper that has its leg curving inwards, that is that has a bow legs, is used for taking external diameter. It is these two legs that are going to hold the woodwork outside and take the diameter. There's not that, that is the total thickness of that woodwork. But the one that has its legs curving outwards is used for taking internal diameter, and that is possible only if the woodwork is hollow, that is, has a hole in it. So it will be deep. So that caliper, you see that it has a tiny leg, so it's not very wide, so that it is able to enter into that hole, and the two legs as they curve outwards, we touch the walls of the hole to take the internal diameter. So that is a caliper. Okay, so this I said is used for taking the external diameter, otherwise the thickness of a woodwork. Why this one here that has this leg curving outwards is deep inside a hollow woodwork. It's used on a hollow woodwork to take the internal diameter and measure and to give you the value. Then last under measuring tools, you have the vernier caliper.
Do over there. Your class is 10 o'clock. This is for GSS 1.
Venn diagram. So the next on the list of the measuring tools is the Vernier caliper. Vernier caliper. So just have the same purposes, only that vernier caliper, like I said before, is more advanced. So it also it has both the inside it has both the inside leg and the outside. So and the outside. So in vernier caliper, you have that used for taking internal diameter, which is this. And that's for taking external diameter. Then it has a control knob here, a screw that can be adjusted to increase or decrease the radius or the diameter of these pins, so that if you want to increase or decrease to a desired length, you can simply do that. And it has a reading on it, a digital reading, as you can see. So it is more advanced. So this control knob here can be used. Is a screw that can be used to adjust the distance between these. So, like I said, these are used for taking an internal diameter, that is of a colo wood door. Why this is used for taking external diameter? As you can see, there's a difference between them. See this, this end here is linear, that is, it is able to hold the wood door firmly. Why? As from the internal one, this part here is outside. You see the difference. So this one that is straight here, that is able to have a firm grip on wood door, is internal here for the one to take a external diameter. Why for this, the upper one that is also for taking internal diameter, you see that edge here is located on the outside, so that you can have a firm grip on the wood door. So now, we move on to, so this is all for measuring tools. For measuring tools. Now we move on to setting out and marking tools. Like I said, please let me remind you, so that by the time you see me go count to the next week, we'll say it's a repetition. Now, topics are not same. There are some topics that will take us up to 2-3 lesson periods to finish. So this particularly, we've made a list of 6 major groups of woodwork tools, and for today we can only cover that of measuring tools and setting out and marking out tools. So inshallah, next week we move on to the other groups of tools. So by the time we are done with this today, we will be left with 4 major groups of woodwork tools. So I'm saying lesson that if you see woodwork tools next week, you will see it. Continuation. Look at the subtopic, you see that it is quite different from the previous one. So now we move on to setting out and marking out tools, the second group of woodwork tools. So setting out and marking out tools. First, let me make a list of the tools under this group. You have the tri square. You have tri square. You have meter square. We have a sliding bevel, otherwise called adjustable bevel. Sliding bevel. We have a wing compass. We have wing compass, or otherwise called the carpenter's compass, and we have a trammel. And we have trammel. These are setting out and marking out tools.
to generally serve two purposes, that is setting good pieces of in the appropriate position and then marking out in assembly, because remember that under the processes I said are involved in technology, assemblage is part of them. That is the bringing together, the joining together of various elements and parts to make one piece of product. That is assemblage. We have so many examples of such products around us that consists of different parts that have been joined together. So when you want to make a woodwork project in assembly, you need to set out, that is to set out the proper positions of each element in relation to one another. That is how they are going to look in assembly. So you have to set out before you start assembling so that you get your things correctly. So try square. These are now tools, like I said, they serve a general purpose of setting the wood pieces together in their proper positions for assembly and then marking out points where we may draw lines, arcs, and circles for sawing and chiseling. That is the area we want, we need to saw, or the area we need to chisel. So we need to first set out and mark out such points before we carry out chiseling or sawing. So now try square. This is what is called the try square. So this is the steel type of a try square. As you can see, it has a two parts, this and this, that are joined at 90 degrees to each other. So as you can see, if you want to draw lines that are perpendicular, set out perpendicular lines on the woodwork. So you want to cut out a woodwork that may be of a rectangular form or a square form in such a way that you have a perfect perpendicular line. This is what you use. So ideally, it is made of one part sticker. This is the outline. It's looking like this. So this part here is thicker than this other one. Why is it made that way? If you want to place it beside a piece of woodwork, so it has to be firm so that it is possible for us to mark out without deviating or leaving the position you want. So this here is thicker. Why this here is embedded in between it? You can't see the other side. I mean, it's possible that you see this reverse side. You understand what I'm saying better? So this here is flat. This inside, this part is flat. And it's embedded into this. In such a way that you have something like this. So this here is just like this. Yes. So this here enters this. Leaving a surplus and that is extra space of this. That is such that it is able to. This here can be placed squarely on the edge of the wooden board so that you mark out a perpendicular line so that you can. So that is the area to the pass through which we saw to cut out a rectangular or square woodwork. So the transfer is used for setting us woodwork as 90 degrees to the edge, as 90 degrees to the edge, that is perpendicular. Where you are, this angle is 90 degrees, that is 90 degrees there. So the second type of setting out here, marking out is the meter square. So the second one is the meter square. Yes, this is the meter square. This is the meter square. If I need to take you through a little mathematics, so that this angles on a straight line, you have means to be 180 degrees. So this is almost similar with the tri square. This is a straight line. So it has the blade. It has two arms. So this instead of as contrast to the tri square where you have this part, this way, and this part this way as 90 degrees. That is at right angles. This there is not same, as if it is bent. So it's not just that this angle here be 45 degrees. So in essence, this other angle is 135 degrees. So whichever angle you need to set out or mark out on wood draw, you need 45 degrees. That means you are using this side. So you can set out a wood draw and mark out at 45 degrees to the edge. I don't know, you may need to make a joint assemblage of wood work at various angles to one hour, maybe of a shape different from a rectangular or square. So you need this. So this angle here measures 45 degrees, right? This here measures 135 degrees. It is used for beveling a meter joint in wood work. And say bev, that is a form of a line or house line that is at oblique and is a diagonal, not vertical or horizontal. So this is used for beveling a meter joints in wood. So next we move on to sliding bevel. Yes. This is a sliding bevel. Okay. So this is a sliding bevel. As you can see, it also has a stock and blade, just like tri square and meter square. But the advantage in this is that it is not fixed. It is not fixed. Now, as you can see, there is no bevel. That means it's adjustable. So you can just adjust to any angle you desire. This is the bevel stock here. That is to mark out using this edge. So at whatever angle you want to mark out or set out, you can use the bevel, sliding bevel, adjustable bevel for that. So this is what is used. It's marked out on a slow face of the wood work. So next we move on to wing compass. Yes, this is what is called wing compass, otherwise called the carpenter compass. So as at least you are familiar with what is instrument called the compass in the drawing instruments and material in the previous topic. So they serve the same purpose. It is used as a metal arc, as you can see. This is a metal arc through which you have a screw, which can be adjusted through them. So it's used for scribing arcs and circles. It's used for scribing arcs and circles. I mean now scribing, not the compass that the master says. That one is used for drawing. But you scribe when you make, when you use a sharp object to make an impression, it leaves an impression on the woodwork, not just drawing using pencil. So it scribes. So that is, it's used, it leaves an impression, just like maybe when you describe a vehicle number on glasses, maybe mirrors for identification. So that's what I'm referring to. So it's kind of leaving impression on the woodwork, or scribing arcs and circles. And this is just similar to trammel. They serve the same purpose. Only that trammel, as you can see, trammel here, the only thing in trammel is you see that it has a screw here for adjustment. Then the difference between them is that trammel can handle larger arcs and circles, which the wing compass may not be able to handle. That is just the difference between them. It has the same purpose for scribing arcs and circles. But square wing compass, otherwise called the carpenter compass, can only handle small sizes of arcs and circles. The trammel is suitable for larger size of arcs and circles to scribe for scribing on woodwork projects. All said and done, I want to believe that he understood very well the lesson taught in the past couple of meanings. So if there any, if there's anybody that doesn't, that didn't understand any part of this, I'm ready to entertain any questions or complaints for better understanding before we call it. Any question?